by age, you mean a complex secret space, and we consider the following spaces, field agent space, all bubble operators, and two special spaces, as you can see in the lower part of the slide. And by C of D, we denote the spectrum of bubble operator D. So now we recall that for the bounded operator D, the classical operator range is a subset defined by the following formula, where the bracket is the inner product in H. And in the case of finite dimensional, if H is finite dimensional, we know that the classical numerical range has the following form. And now we recall some basic properties of the classical numerical ranges. And for the bounded operator, we see that the subset is invariant under unitary similarity, lies in the closed disk of radius 6 and the origin, contains all eigenvalues, and the last, which is quite easy to see that the dimension of H is finite, then the classical numerical range is compact. For us, the most important thing is the property number 5. It's quite simple, but really useful. And point number 3. So the last property follows from the compactness and the appropriate function. And the proofs of this property can be found in classical book written by Roger Horn and Charles Johnson in case of matrices, but in the case of finite dimensional space H is quite similar. Next, four important theorems. The first, the spectrum of operator D is containing closure of the classical numerical range. And the theorem number 3, which is somewhat, we can put this in more general assumption, but if the H, if X is a subjoint operator, then the closure of the classical numerical range is the product sum of the spectrum of X. The next, the set of the numerical classical numerical range of D lies in real line even only if D is subjoint. And the last, the classical numerical range of D is a convex set. This is quite interesting theorem. And now let us show two examples. The first, we consider the backward shift operator, and still that this norm is equal 1, and by theorem number 1, we know that this classical numerical range is contained in the closed unit disk. In fact, one can prove that this classical numerical range is open disk centered at the origin, and we prove the radius equal 1. And the next is really quite important because space H, we can construct an example with non-closed numerical range. In this example, we consider the sequence of the positive real numbers such that they are going decreasing D to the zero. And we can look at the D as an operator whose matrix, in finite dimensional matrix, we present the standard for normal basis, is a diagonal. Then the classical numerical range has the form as you can see. Next, theorem number 8, and this is the theorem which comes from the original paper of G. von Mischer. And for the following spaces, is one of the following spaces, the following conditions are equivalent. First, that if I preserve the closure of the classical numerical range, and the second, that for n subjoint operator X, the operator P identity minus X is positive defined if and only if following positive defined. And the proof is following. Observe that if the first condition holds and it's clear by our characterization from theorem number 1 that phi of identity is an identity, and for every x the operator phi of x is self-adjoint, even only if x is self-adjoint. This is the consequence of theorem number 4. And we can mention that in our case, if X is self-adjoint, then the classical numerical range is the convex sum of the spectrum, which we use further. And notice that the identity minus is positive defined if and only if D is greater than the maximum spectrum. And minus the identity plus X positive defined if suppose that he's the one who follows spaces, and that A is the form of this x plus y, where x and y are self-adjoint. And it's enough to observe that the closure of W of A of A lies in this half plane if and only if the self-adjoint operator of the following form is positively defined for any given determinant. Then, but by the condition number two, we see that this is if and only if the identity plus k phi of x minus phi of y is positively defined for all t greater than p. And thus, the closure of phi of a is contained in the closed half plane if and only if the closure of w of a is contained in p. And hence, we got the equality of two convex compact sets. And the first condition holds. Now, we would like to present the main theorem. I would like to prove this group is based on the original paper. I would like to emphasize that I would like to present some ideas and some nice facts to prove this theorem without many difficulty days. I refer to the original paper from this whole technical days. And let me be one of the following spaces, and then for a searcher between our map, the following conditions are equivalent. And the map spy preserve the spectra of all self-adjoint elements x from y. Phi is continuous and preserve the spectra of all orthogonal projections, meaning projection which is self-adjoint. The next, the phi preserve the classical numerical range. The fourth, phi preserve the closure of the classical numerical range. And the condition number five, that the our operator phi must have the special form which we can see in this slide. And we have to mention that the subjectivity assumption cannot be omitted in the case if the H is a three-dimensional space. The authors present appropriate proof of the present appropriate example of the operator, which is not subjective. We satisfy condition number 1, 2, 3, and 4, but do not satisfy condition number 5. And in the case of finite dimensional space H, the subjectivity assumption can be omitted. And if you look at, recall some quiet non-theorem by Marcus Mois, we see that our theorem of G-complete, Sherman, and Rodman is an extension of the following theorem, that for an endomorphism of square matrices with complex entries, the following conditions are equivalent. That the endomorphism gamma preserves the spectrum with multiplicities, and the second one is that the gamma S, sometimes we call it the PQ standard form or the classical form, with PQ equal identity matrix. And now we can notice that the following sequence of implication is quite easy to see. And to complete our proof is enough to prove the following sequence of information. So now we suppose that the second point holds. And we use the quite interesting idea, which is not trivial, that the set of all self-adjoint operators with finite spectra is identical to the set of all self-adjoint operators. So we start with this. So suppose that the operator X has a finite spectrum, and that X can be expressed in the following sum, where P sub 1, P sub n are eigenvalues, P sub I are orthogonal projections, and then we made a small calculation, and then we can show, using this calculation, that the maximum sigma phi of x is greater than equal to P sub 1. In this case, this inequality is the standard partial order in the set of all self-adjoint operators. In fact, Dr. Linus introduced it in the previous lecture, in the previous talk. And then, if we can take the t greater equal than t sub 1, then the identity minus phi of x is positive semi-defined. And thus, if we collect this whole information, then we can see that the maximum sigma phi of x is equal to the maximum sigma of x. In similar case, using the similar argument, we can show that the minimum sigma phi of x is equal to the minimum sigma of the music hero number 8, we get the quality once again. And then the condition number 4 holds. So suppose now the condition number 4 holds, and because we have the axis of the joint in the spectral rank is the norm, so we can see, in fact, that the x, the norm of x, is equal to the norm of phi of x, and this is the reason of the condition number 4. So we see that phi is continuous, in fact, this is a metric. So next we see that the phi of identity is identity by the theorem number 1, and now we can extend, if we suppose that we can extend the phi, the complex map, from the set of all bounded operators, or bounded operators of special form, by the following formula, where x and y are self-adjoint or self-adjoint with addition condition, as I mentioned. Thirdly, phi x conjugate is the same as phi x conjugate. And by theorem number 8, we see and our phi preserve the closure of the classical numerical range on the spaces P of H and P sub K of H. And now we would like to use the theorem of Pellegrini from 1975, which stated in our condition, I mentioned in this place that the classical numerical range is just the same, something with the norm of the numerical range considered in this paper. Because the numerical range can be defined in Banach algebras, and in this case, the authors called it non-numerical range. But in our case, these two definitions coincidence. So, if we use the theorem of Pellegrini, we know that the phi must be a sister automorphism, Jordan automorphism, and using this fact that the phi is isometric, or maybe we can use the Cartesian theorem, then we got that the phi has the for less than the point number 5. And this is the end of the proof. As I mentioned, if someone has any doubts, I refer to the original paper, proof of the original paper, or we can talk about this after this lecture, this talk. So now, definition number 2, because we would like to certain generalization of our theorem in a sense of parametrical range. So for a positive integer k less than the dimension of h, we put the following set, where p is in this place the orthogonal projection, and this set is called the parametrical range. The parametrical range has many applications, in particular in quantum algebra, especially in quantum coupling theorem or error correction theory. So some authors thought that it's really important to study the current numerical ranges. And we got the quite fresh theorem, which states that if P is the one of the following spaces, of the space of all bounded operators, or the space of all self-adjoint operators, then for a surjective R map, phi and following conditions are equivalent. That the phi preserve the current numerical range. Second, that the phi preserve the closure of the current numerical range, and the third, that the operator phi has the following form, which is our automorphism and anti-automorphism, and we can see the authors prove the subjectivity assumption of phi can be removed if the dimension is finite, and the proof of this theorem can be found in position numbers in the derivative. And in fact, it's the end of my lecture.
Are there any questions? If not, let's thank the superintendent. And this was the last talk, so please feel your